Dear friends, this is episode number 37 of the Limitation Act. We were dealing with the scope of Article 134 of the Limitation Act and also the question whether after that period limited therein, period provided therein, whether a suit would lie by the auction purchaser. Now, I said that I will cite some decisions of the Supreme Court and one decision of the Kerala High Court. And then we will have a discussion on that point and I will give my opinion. The first decision I would like to cite is 2006-3 SEC 49, same as AIR 2006 Supreme Court 1458. Name of the case: Balakrishnan versus Malayandi Konar, MALAIYANTI Konar. Two judges of the Supreme Court by Justices Arijit Pasayat and Justice R.V. Ravindran, two eminent judges of the Supreme Court. There, the facts are relevant. Execution petition was filed by the appellant on 13-8-93 under Rule 95. Of Order 21 CPC for delivery. It was contended that the application was filed beyond 1 year as provided under Article 134 of the Limitation Act. In that situation, the Supreme Court held in paragraph 12, I am not reading the whole thing. The limitation for the purpose of Article 134 starts from the date of confirmation of sale and not from the date of when the sale certificate is issued. There was a controversy on that, and it is well settled that, that is when the sale becomes absolute, because the third column of Article 134 of the Limitation Act clearly provides that when the sale becomes absolute. Sale certificate may be issued later. That is not the starting point of limitation. In Pattam Kadar Khan versus Pattam Sardar Khan and another, 1996-5 SEC 48, this court held that it is not from the date when the sale certificate is issued that the limitation starts running. Correct. The sale becomes absolute on confirmation under Order 21 Rule 92 of the code, effectively passing title. That is also correct. Then further down, the period of 1 year limitation now prescribed under Article 134 of the Limitation Act, in substitution of 3 year period provided under Article 180 of the Indian Limitation Act 1908, is reflective of the legislative policy of finalizing proceedings in execution as quickly as possible by providing a quick forum to the auction purchaser to ask for the delivery of possession of property purchased within that period from the date of sale becoming absolute, rather than from the date of issue of sale certificate. On his failure to avail such a quick remedy, the law relegates him to the remedy of a regular suit for possession based on title, subject again to limitation. So here the Supreme Court clearly held, two judges, very eminent judges, that on failure to avail such a quick remedy, under the 1908 Limitation Act, the period of limitation for making the application for delivery was 3 years. Now it has been made 1 year. The purpose is to provide a quick remedy that is not to destroy the right. That is almost clear from the judgment. It is not said in so many words. On his failure to avail such a quick remedy, the law relegates him to the remedy of a regular suit for possession based on title, subject again to limitation. Then disposed of accordingly. Next decision is 2005-9 SEC 354. In KHC also it is seen 2005 KHC 1556. K.R. Lakshmi Narayana Rao versus New Premier Chemical Industries. That is also two judges. Justice S.P. Sinha and Justice S.H. Kapadia. Justice Kapadia later became Chief Justice of India. Justice S.P. Sinha is a very eminent judge of the Supreme Court. His lordship has rendered ever so many judgments on various aspects. There, a separate suit to enforce such a right would not be maintainable, is the view taken. Steps for obtaining delivery of property in occupancy of judgmentor is required to be taken by the auction purchaser in terms of Order 21, Rule 95. A separate suit to enforce such a right would not be maintainable. Now, before going to this decision, I may invite your attention to two rules of Order 21. Otherwise, it may not be proper for me to read all these things and leave it at that. Order 21, rules 95 and 96. What is 95? Delivery of property in the occupancy of judgmentor. Where the immoved property is sold is in the occupancy of the judgmentor or some person on his behalf or of some person claiming under a title created by the judgmentor subsequent to the attachment of such property and a certificate in respect thereof has been granted under Rule 94, the court shall, on the application of the purchaser, order delivery to be made by putting such purchaser or any person whom he may appoint to receive delivery on his behalf in possession of the property and if needed by removing any person who refuses to vacate the same. So that an auction purchaser is entitled to take delivery under Rule 95 if that property is in the possession of the judgmentor or some person claiming under him or a subsequent purchaser who is bound by it, bound by the proceedings. Now Rule 96, delivery of property in the occupancy of tenant. Where the property sold is in the occupancy of a tenant or other person entitled to occupy the same and a certificate in respect thereof has been granted under Rule 94. The court shall, on the application of the purchaser, order delivery to be made by affixing a copy of the certificate of sale in some conspicuous part of the property and proclaiming to the occupant by beat of drum or other customary mode at some convenient place that the interest of the judgmentor has been transferred to the purchaser. That is what is called symbolic delivery. So 95 speaks of a situation where the property is in the possession of the judgmentor or a person who is bound by the proceedings against the judgmentor. So that in effect it is in the possession of the judgmentor. 96 is delivery of property in the occupancy of tenant. Suppose a money decree obtained by A against B. B's property, immoral property, sold in court auction. Purchased either by A or by a stranger. But B had inducted a tenant in the building in the property. That tenant is not bound to vacate. He has got his own right to remain until he steps are taken to evict him as per law. Whether the rent control legislation applies or not. So that he cannot be ousted and his possession cannot be disturbed. But at the same time, delivery is to be effected. How? By effecting symbolic delivery. Under Rule 96. These are the two methods for effecting delivery under the CPC. Now we go to the decision. Steps for obtaining delivery of the property in the occupancy of the judgmentor is required to be taken by the auction purchaser in terms of Rule 95. A separate suit to enforce such right would not be maintainable. See, a diametrically opposite view. Diametrically opposite view. This decision was not referred to in 2006. So, two decisions of two judges each taking diametrically opposite views. Now, let us see. There it was a money decree. Lakshmi Narayan Rao, I set the citation 2009 SEC 354. Name of the case is K.R. Lakshmi Narayan Rao versus New Premier Chemical Industries. K.R. Lakshmi Narayan Rao versus New Premier Chemical Industries. It was a money decree. Execution proceedings were taken. A land was sold. The plaintiff decree holder himself purchased the property. That was in 1972. The auction sale was confirmed in 1973. However, against that, an appeal, at that time appeal was maintainable, execution appeal, and it was filed and it was dismissed only in 1974. Sales certificate was issued in 1980. So, sale was confirmed in 1973. The High Court proceedings ended in 1974. But the sale certificate was issued only in 1980. So, going by Article 134, the period starts from the date of confirmation of the sale, date when the sale becomes absolute, and not from the date when the sale certificate is issued. Though on a reading of Rule 94, 95 and 96, it would indicate that sale certificate is necessary. That is necessary for effecting delivery. True, but culmination of the proceedings, not for initiating. In the year 98, the plaintiff filed a suit for a declaration of title and possession of the property. So, period of 1 year was over. He did not take any steps to obtain delivery of possession under Rule 95 because evidently it was barred. So, he filed a suit. Auction purchaser filed a suit. For declaration of title and possession of the suit property. Trial court dismissed that suit. In that context, it was held in paragraph 8 and 9. 8, not only 8, 9, 8, 9, 11, 12, 13 and 14. I will read only a few sentences. It was held that once a decree is satisfied, when delivery is effected, the decree is satisfied. Then there is no question of invoking Article 136. Is the view. But 36 is filing an execution petition, 12 years period. So that one may ask, I obtained a decree, I am an auction purchaser. A decree holder has got, I am the decree holder auction purchaser. I have got 12 years period to file a suit, file an execution petition. And therefore, even if the application is not filed within 1 year under Article 134, I can file an execution petition under Article 136. The Supreme Court here says that once that proceeding under Rule 95 or 96, as the case may be, of Order 21 is over, it comes to an end. Therefore, thereafter, it is not possible to invoke Article 136 and file an execution petition. There cannot be any doubt whatsoever that when a decree is satisfied, the execution case comes to an end. Once a decree is satisfied, the question of invoking the provisions of Article 136 would not arise, in as much as a bare perusal thereof would clearly show that the same would be attracted when an application is filed for executing the decree. Then further held, the schedule appended to the Limitation Act 1963 having provided for a specific provision prescribing limitation for filing an appropriate application for recovery of possession of any property in the possession of judge mandatar. It is idle to contend that Article 136 of the Limitation Act would apply. That was the focus of discussion, whether an execution petition would lie. If so, 12 years period is there from the date of decree, date when the decree becomes enforceable. The law enunciated by the majority decision of the full bench of the Calcutta High Court that was followed. Then in para 11, I am not reading the rest of para 10. Para 11 reference is made to AER 1983 Supreme Court 1201. Nandrani Majumdar versus Indian Airlines, and where it was held that we indicated to the counsel for the respondent that even if there be some force in the plea that a separate suit did not lie, though the argument advanced by so-and-so of the appellant in support of the stand that a separate suit for the reliefs claimed would lay was forceful, the suit could, as a measure ex debito justitiae, be treated as an execution petition. There is good authority for converting an execution application into a suit, and there could, in our opinion, be no valid objection to the counter process of converting a suit into an execution proceeding. So, in that Nandrani Majumdar's case, it was held that when a suit is filed, it could be treated as an execution petition. If it can be treated as an execution petition, Article 136 will apply, where the period of limitation will be 12 years. That these benches do not accept. A bare perusal of the said judgment, therefore, would clearly go to show that although it was held therein that a separate suit would not be maintainable for the purpose of recovery of possession of the property which was in the possession of the judge mandatar, but their lordships proceeded to grant relief to the decree holder ex debito justitiae by directing that the plain be treated as an application under Order 21, Rule 95 of the Code of Civil Procedure. Then it says, not Rule 95, that was not what the Supreme Court said, can be converted into an execution application. Need not be Rule 94, 95. Such a course could have been taken recourse to if finding could have been arrived at by the trial court that the suit filed by the plaintiff was within the prescribed period of limitation. That is this 1 year. What the Supreme Court in this case, the present case which we are dealing with, 2009 2005 9 SCC 354, what their lordships say, that though that judgment it says so, Nandrani's, it can be treated as an execution application provided it is within the period of limitation provided under Article 134. This is what the Supreme Court says. So that the deadlock of 1 year is there. keeping in view the fact that the sale was confirmed in the year 1973 and the execution appeal filed by the respondent judge meritor was dismissed in the year 1974, in terms of Article 134 of the Limitation Act, the application under Order 21 Rule 95 was required to be filed by the respondent herein within a period of 1 year thereafter. So after the High Court proceedings are over, it should have been filed within 1 year. This is the view. So we have seen two decisions. One, Justice Pasayath and Justice Ravindran, 2006. The other, Justice S.P. Sinha, Justice S.H. Kapadia, in 2005, 9 SCC. Now we will see a three-judge bench decision. In 1973, 2 SCC, 4, 6, 7. That is AER 1973 Supreme Court, 2423. Harnand Rai, Badri Das versus Debi Dutt Bhagavadi Prasad. Order for Section 47 and Order 21 Rule 95 were considered, and questions arising between the auction purchaser and judge meritor should be determined by the executing court and not by a separate suit. This is what the Supreme Court said. What is the question posed in that case? Paragraph 1. The appeal by certificate from a judgment of the Calcutta High Court raises an important question as to whether, after an auction sale in execution of a decree holder auction purchaser can move the executing court for delivery of vacant possession of an immoled property, or whether he has to file a separate suit to get that possession. That was the question referred to. That was the question which was considered by the Supreme Court. Whether he can file an application to get delivery. This is 73, before 1976 amendment. And therefore, that question was relevant at that time. Section 47 was not like this at that time. Then this question was considered. And various decisions were referred to. We are in respectful agreement with Justice G.K. Mitter. That was Calcutta High Court. A decision was referred to. Justice Mitter later went to Supreme Court. We are in respectful agreement with Justice G.K. Mitter that the legislature must have thought that the duty of the executing court should not end with the confirmation of sale. And it is because the legislature thought that the auction purchaser should have the right of applying for possession under the provisions of Rule 95 and Rule 96. That proceedings for obtaining possession were included in the catena of rules relating to execution of decree. It is important to para 8. It is important to remember that after the decision of the Privy Council in Ganapathy's case, AER 1917 PC 121, there has been an amendment of Section 47 as a result of which the purchaser at a sale in execution of a decree, whether he is the decree holder or not, is unquestionably a party to the suit for the purpose of Section 47. Having regard to this, all questions arising between the auction purchaser and the judgmentor must, in our view, be determined by the executing court and not by a separate suit. Question posed was different. Whether a suit has to be filed or whether in the execution proceeding itself he will get delivery. It is just the opposite. Here the question which we are raising is that if no application is filed under Article 134, whether a suit will lie for getting at the property, for getting possession of the property on the basis of title of the auction purchaser. There in the three bench judge, 73 Supreme Court, it was different. Question was the other way about, but anyhow, it is a Supreme Court judgment. When one sentence is said, that is binding on us. Not having regard to this, all questions arising between the auction purchaser and the judgmentor, in our view, be determined by the executing court and not by a separate suit. True. That was considering the question whether an application would lie for delivery of possession. There the Supreme Court said it is not by a suit but by an application, execution application, that you have to get delivery. This question which arises now for our consideration was never the question before the Supreme Court in 1973. Therefore, I will say that this is not a binding precedent. There are two other decisions which are conflicting. Three judge bench decision is not, according to me, my humble view, it is not a binding precedent, because the question which was considered by the Supreme Court in that decision is quite different from the question which arises for consideration for the present. We will see in the next episode. Thank you.